Hi everybody, and welcome to MATH-segnale. Today, we will share with you one of our favorite problems, which we consider almost a work of art. Fix three spheres tangent to each other. Our aim is to construct another chain of spheres such that every sphere is tangent to the initial three, and the next sphere in the chain is tangent to the previous one. Ready?
Wait, I don't get it. Even the initial data seems very complicated. So I fix one sphere somewhere with a certain radius. Then I fix a second sphere, and this must be tangent to the first one. And even if I fix the radius, there are so many possibilities.
And don't forget that one sphere could be inside another one.
Oh, right. This is even more complicated than I expected, but assume I fix this second sphere. Then the third must be tangent to the first and the second. And even now there are so many possibilities.
This is why I find so amazing this problem. It seems very complicated. However, you will see how elegant and beautiful the solution will be. Let's start again. You fix the initial spheres in any way you like. Now we are ready to construct our chain of blue spheres. We start with the first sphere that has to be tangent to our three initial spheres. Then you can construct the second one. It has to be tangent to the three initial spheres and to the first blue sphere. And then you can try to construct the third, the fourth, and so on.
Wait, how do I know if it's possible? How do I know these spheres exist?
You don't. In fact, this is the problem. How can this chain behave? There are two possibilities. The chain is finite, so at a certain point you can't find another blue sphere, or the chain is infinite.
Right. And I assume that depending on the choices of the initial spheres, you can realize all these possibilities.
In theory, yes, but the beauty of the problem is that for all the possible initial conditions, the answer is always the same. It does not matter how you put the three initial spheres. The chain is always finite. More, it has always six spheres. More, the last blue sphere is always tangent to the first. Look at this example.
What a beautiful picture. But how do I know that these spheres are really tangent? And how do I know that for other choices of the initial spheres, then the result is still the same?
We are going to prove it. But first, look how amazing are these animations where the blue chain rotates. And trust me when I say that the beauty of this problem is not all in the result, but also in the proof. The magic is done by a construction called spherical inversions. I will cheat a little bit and I will talk about circular inversion, which are the analogous but in two dimensions. But everything I will say about circles and lines will be true for spheres and planes. Take a circle with center C and radius R. A circular inversion of a point P is another point Q which lies on the same ray and such that CP times CQ equals R squared. As you notice, the points on the circle are fixed since their distance is exactly R. The points inside the circles will go outside and vice versa. Every point in the plane can be transformed with this circular inversion, except one. Can you figure out which one?
It seems that the center C cannot be transformed, right? Because this product is always zero.
Well done! So let's go for other properties. First of all, we can transform images, not only points. Simply, we transform every point of this image.
Amazing! It looks like a distorted mirror.
Right, the circular inversions almost work like a mirror. So, okay, we will use this term and we will call the circle mirror. For our aim, we are interested in transformation of circles and lines. All the following facts come from Euclidean geometry, and we will leave you in description a link with some proofs. It's not difficult to see that if you take a line or a circle and you transform it, you will get either a line or a circle. But we can be more precise. Can you figure out what is the transformation of this line passing through C?
So every point just stays on the same line, so the line should be the same.
Exactly! Well, almost the same, since C cannot be transformed, but you can think that C goes to infinity, so yes, a line through C will be transformed in the same line.
What happens if the line does not pass through C?
In this case, it is slightly more difficult to prove, but you will get a circle passing through C. You can ask, what about circles? Well, if you take a circle not passing through C, it will be transformed in a circle not passing through C.
And what about circle passing through C?
Well, in this case, which is the last case, you get a line not passing through C. There is one last fact that we need, which is that circular inversions preserve tangency in the set circles and lines. For instance, if you take two tangent circles, then their image will be tangent, and the same holds if you have a line and a circle.
What if the tangency point is the center of the mirror?
I'm glad you asked it. It will come back later. Take these two tangent circles and move them such that the tangency point will become the center of the mirror. As you can see, the two circles will be transformed in two lines, parallel lines. This came from the fact that these two circles have only one intersection point, which is the center of the mirror, and the center of the mirror has no image. In a certain sense, the two parallel lines are tangent at infinity. However, for our problem, we don't need circular inversion, but spherical inversion. But wait, the same properties holds in this case. You have only to replace lines with planes and circles with spheres. Now we are ready to approach the problem. Do you have any idea on how to use inversions?
Well, if I start from the example you showed me, I can fix a mirror sphere and do the inversion. And I will get three different initial spheres and still the chain of six blue spheres.
Correct. If you know that for a specific position of the three initial spheres, there will be always six spheres in the blue chain, then the same property hold when you transform with a spherical inversion the three initial spheres into a new configuration.
But how does this help me with the problem? First, you claimed that this was a solution, but you still didn't prove it. Then the problem was about every possible initial configuration, so it seems there is still work to do.
I have one more trick to show you. What happens if the center of the mirror is on one of the three initial spheres?
I expect the problem to break, because the yellow sphere will become a plane.
Break? Why? The tangency conditions still hold. Only we have to say that these conditions are between spheres and planes, and not only between spheres. So, let's check what happens.
As I said, the yellow sphere will become a plane. Then the red sphere will still be a sphere tangent to this plane, and so will be the green sphere. And the green and the red will still be tangent to each other.
And what about the chain of blue spheres?
They will still be a chain of blue spheres, this time all of them also tangent to the yellow plane.
You see? The problem did not break. You have to think about spheres and planes, or planes as if they were very big spheres with very big radius and center at infinity. So, from now on, we will talk about planes and spheres as if they were the same thing. Now it's time to solve the problem. So let's start with the configuration of the three initial spheres, and we don't know anything about the blue chain. The trick is to use the spherical inversion to construct a new setting of the three initial spheres in which the problem is easier. So we can choose the mirror sphere such that its center is in the tangency point between the yellow and the green sphere. What happens?
They will become planes, parallel planes, exactly as in the example with the circles. And then the red sphere will still be a sphere tangent to these two planes.
Did you see why the problem is now easier? All the blue spheres have to be tangent to both the planes, and so they will have all the same diameter, which is the same diameter of the red sphere and which is equal to the distance between the two planes. So, how many spheres can you fit around the red one?
So, since all the centers are on the same plane, we can reason by using circles. So let R be the radius of the red circle, then R will be also the radius of the blue circles. Since they are all tangent to the red circle, their center will be at distance 2R from the center of the red circle. So fix the first blue circle, then the next blue circle has a center which has a distance 2R with the center of the first blue circle. But wait! This is an equilateral triangle, so we can go on adding more and more circles, and the centers of the blue circle will form a regular hexagon. So yes, there are just 6 blue circles, and the last one is tangent to the first one.
Great! Then you simply have to go back in the 3D world, and getting back to the original configuration, you will have your 6 spheres. Moreover, all these chains can be obtained simply rotating the blue chain between the two planes.
Here we are. The chain has 6 spheres. Always. Every time a problem has such a clean answer, there is always some beauty behind it. The amazing thing is that the apparent complexity of this problem we described at the beginning magically disappears once we use the tool of spherical inversions. As mathematicians, we love when the proof is as beautiful as the result itself. This construction is known as Soddy's hexlet, from the name of the mathematician who proved this theorem. This result was also discovered in Japan before. Look at these wonderful pictures.
If you like this problem, we have some challenges for you. First of all, we forgot a little note in the statement. Can you figure out what happens if the three initial spheres are tangent in the same point? And about the other note in the statement, can you figure out how many spheres can degenerate into planes and when is it possible? That's all for today. We really hope you liked this little piece of art. And from Riccardo and Davide, ciao!